Shri Drabu.
Morning, everybody. Thanks, SEWA-INBI and SEWA for inviting me to participate in this. As Sharad said, this was initially supposed to be a conversation between me and Arvind, and then it was transformed into a conversation with them. But nevertheless, I think it's an important thing. And we start with a confession that that when I announced it in my budget this January, that our intent to move towards some form of a universal basic income, I wasn't quite aware of the enormous amount of literature, academic discussions, and in ideological activism on this issue. I was rather innocent of all this. And for me, it was really a very simple policy issue, encouraged as I was by an experiment, a small experiment that I had done with the security and welfare of construction workers. I also happened to have the charge of the as Minister of Labour, and in that I had tried to create a social security envelope for the construction workers and other workers, which forms a part of a board, the Board for Construction and Other Workers. By restructuring the way we were spending the labor cess that almost all state governments levy and collect from industry for the welfare of construction workers. Typically what happens is that we collect a cess, which in our case is around 500 crores for JNK. It's a small state. We don't have much of an industry, but we still managed to collect about 500 crores. And when I kind of looked at how it was utilized, it was a usual sense that, you know, if a worker dies, and then you give 2 lakhs. If there's an injury, then 1 lakh. If there's a disability, 1.5 lakh. And it was more an administrative kind of activity, which would take anywhere between 6 months to a year for the beneficiary to get benefits, and we would still retain a large corpus. But what I did was really to start off by saying that, look, first, if somebody gets hurt or injured or dies, there must be immediate relief. So let's not wait for this whole process to happen. So I created a unique cash credit facility for the worker after registering. We have about 3.5 lakh construction workers. We registered all of them, seeded them Aadhaar, on the basis of Aadhaar, and created a cash credit facility of 10,000, which he could access the moment there's any incident that happens. You know, there's an accident, injury, whatever. So he doesn't have to wait for a certain process for the government to formalize. Then it goes from the deputy secretary level to the secretary level, and then gets whatever. And then it eventually, by the time he gets it, it's 6 months, 7 months into the thing. So first we created that 10,000. But along with that, we created a whole set of things in terms of insurance using the existing forms. So the Construction Workers Board itself took initiative to give insurance comprehensive accident insurance for 2 lakhs, life insurance for 2 lakhs, health insurance for 30,000 bucks, and then on top of this facility. So instead of now paying 2 lakhs on death, for instance, once the insurance happens, that amount is paid through the insurance company. What it has allowed me to do is, A, to ramp up the education assistance for the families, and second, in phase two, is to start an income supplementing program for workers. Because I don't want this corpus to remain at, you know, at that level and utilize it only for death and disability. But if we are able to, because of this insurance, comprehensive insurance, where we are using the existing Pradhan Mantri schemes and other schemes and our own schemes for 3.5 lakh construction workers, we are also providing some family insurance. So you are really targeting about 15 lakh people, providing them covers for accidents and unfortunate events, but also because we are able to leverage this whole insurance thing, we are now looking at phase two, where we are saying that can we supplement the income of these construction workers, who I see as a subset of the overall BPL population. So it started off with this, and from a policy perspective, I thought that, you know, then can we graduate from this number of 3.5 lakh to whatever lakh numbers we have for BPL population. That's how I approach this issue, because we now have almost, if you were to take 3 lakh workers and a family size of 5, 15 lakh people somewhere have been provided some security by the government. From here to move on to the larger set. And the biggest advantage which J&K has, and I'm going to first specifically speak about J&K, is that our numbers are very small, very, very small numbers. So to give you a sense of it, our total population is 1.25 crore people. Our BPL population is 15 to 18 lakh people. And we have an SDP of about 1 lakh crores. We do a welfare spending of, currently in the budget, between 5,000 crores to 6,000 crores. These are ballpark numbers. And so when I argue for a case that let's do a pilot in J&K, it was based on this, that our numbers are very, very small and manageable. So the proposition and the idea that I floated in the budget was not just simple, but very simple-minded. The idea being that can we pool all the social spending that we have today, and I'll make it a little more refined as I go along, can we pool all our current social spending, center states, together, and do a direct beneficiary transfer for people below the poverty line? And we have about, as I said, 15 to 18 lakh people. Now, the back of envelope arithmetic appeared to be very attractive to me, which I did mention in some of the, you know, in the budget itself, is that currently our social spend is between 5 to 7% of GDP, our SDP, which is 5,000 to 7,000 crores. Assuming that per beneficiary household of 5 lakhs, we have 5 lakhs, I'm taking an outer number now. I'll come down to that, it's actually, arithmetic is much better. Assuming a beneficiary households of 5 lakhs, UBI per household per year, 1 lakh. We are arriving at a total cost of 5,000 crores, which is exactly what we are spending today. In fact, this is a huge overestimate, as I'll kind of share later, because we don't have 5 lakh families. We have 3.5 lakh families, which are BPL families, BPL households. And the total cost in our SDP terms remains at around 5%. So it doesn't really shock the system very much in terms of the fiscal consequences or whatever. Now, we can, of course, as I said, refine these numbers. For instance, our BPL population is 18 lakhs, and we are really talking of 3.5 lakh households, in which case, the numbers, again, come down, and you're looking at 3,500, which gives you certain flexibility. But when you look at this spend that has been done so far, and you map it, what is happening is that the poorer households in richer districts corner a lot of resources, so that the poorer household in richer districts get much better social spending shares than the poorer households in poorer districts. Now, the district mapping is there because the fact is that your entire plan process is done on that basis. Your allocations of CSS and others happen in that fashion. A broad number is that 42% of the poor get 30% share in the spending. So there obviously is a problem even in the current levels. So we are, having talked about the overall level of spending, the structure of spending is such it actually is not benefiting the real poor. So there is need for transformation even there. There are three basic kinds of social spending we are doing at this point of time. One is this whole thing, which is a financial aid, which is like a pension, a widow's, destitute. We're doing about 2,500 crores of this, which is again not very different from a cash transfer. So you have these pensions and widow pensions and all kinds of things added to 2,500, which is really, if you can substitute that without any issue. Then you have this one category of social spending, which is you are trying to, it's a social intervention spending. A nutritional deficit is being addressed through a midday meal scheme. Those kinds of spendings, we are doing about 500 crores. I'm talking of J&K. And then you have the pure subsidy, which is implicit in the price and where you want to kind of provide some welfare spending, which is food and, let's say, power, we are doing about 2,000 crores of it. So that's a breakup for 5,000. Now, straight away, 2,500 doesn't need any form of change. You just have to reorganize the system. So 50% of the problem is really just not just an administrative or an organizational change. You could still continue with the intervention spending, which is like a midday meal and all, though I have my strict views on it, and you see what kind of quality issues are there and leakages and all that, which is very well documented. And in terms of subsidy, you can certainly move towards a much better targeted thing, both in terms of food and whatever. So you have resources, is not the constraint. Budgetary resources. The only issue is that the fiscal cost of this move will not be only in budgetary terms. Once you move to a basic income for whichever category, BPL or whatever, correspondingly, you will have to jack up the other rates, whether it's for casual workers, DRWs, in irrigation department, ad hoc workers, because then this will act, this amount that you do transfer, whichever amount it is, will act as the support price for in that market. So you will have a huge demand coming up for recalibrating your entire payment structure after this is done. But one can work out, and these are, I don't see the move to UBI as a overnight move like the GST. It certainly has to be first a pilot, then phases, then you can look at various permutations, combinations, which segment you want to target and how much you want to do. So one can work out various permutation combinations for this, but what it does in policy terms is that it gives me tremendous amount of leeway and policy flexibility in managing public expenditure, which I'll come to later. But we have huge issues in managing our current things. For instance, the biggest challenge will be we have 6 BPL lists in J&K. The planning department has its own BPL list. The rural development department has its own BPL list. The food supplies CAPD department has its own BPL list. The social welfare department has its own BPL list. The education department has its own BPL list. And even the power department, the power development department, has its own BPL list. And these lists range from 5 lakh people of the power department to 25 lakh people of the social welfare department. First rough cut exercise which I got done to consolidate these lists, anchored in the food supplies department, we are looking at about 15 to 18 lakh people, which is why I said about 3.5 lakh households. And what kind of spendings are these done? And each department has its own social spend, its little small little thing, even including forest department. In J&K, for instance, a state small, we are running 26 Meritcom scholar schemes, Meritcom poverty scholars. We are running 14 marriage assistance schemes. And we are running about half a dozen widow pension schemes. Nobody has a clue of who gets it. Is the same guy getting it twice over? And the sums we are talking of are not small. They range from 80 crores to 100 crores, I mean, in each of these things. So there is no kind of uniform pattern whereby you would be able to track. It's not biometric based, not Aadhaar based. It's right now a free for all. And when you audit it, then it's a whole series of things which one can get into. That is one part of the story. Administratively, how we administer our current social welfare spending. Second is to go on ground. Now, when I go on ground to my constituency, for instance, and I visit, I happen to see an Anganwadi center. So you enter into an Anganwadi center and check, there's a small room, and I ask how many kids are being fed here. So about 60. The room that is the Anganwadi center cannot accommodate more than 10 people. Nevertheless, so you move forward and say, okay, 60 people, where are the plates in which they eat? They get their own plates, all right. Where are the vessels in which you cook for those 60 kids? There are none. I mean, where do you wash these utensils if there are any? There's no space. I mean, it's a complete racket. I have seen, at least in my constituency, the Anganwadi centers, A, have gone to only political workers of particular parties. He's your worker, his biggest demand today as an MLA, I can tell you there are only three or four demands that I get. Either for an IAY case or for a Anganwadi center or whatever, and this is the way largesse is created. And then there's a market for Anganwadi work, centers. You give it to your political worker, then he sells it. And I can show you, now that everybody has a mobile phone with a camera and a video facility, people send you stuff that, you know, there's a proper marketing of Anganwadi centers happening. And then the amount you spend, which is not a part of this whole social spending, is the salary of Anganwadi workers. And not only there are Anganwadi workers, there are now helpers to Anganwadi workers. And there's an interesting category called supervisor to helper to the Anganwadi worker. I mean, what we have, if you add all that here, we are not in J&K spending less than 7,500 crores, including salary bills, which brings me to the other category that your social spending is revenue and capital. Now, capital also becomes a welfare spending when you make this Anganwadi center and do all kinds of things with it. So you have a capital spend also on it. When you add up all this, we are talking of much larger numbers. In fact, my own sense is that if you were to pull together, at least in J&K, we'll do a saving of 2,000 to 3,000 crores. Once you do not just the benefits of aggregation are phenomenal, but also in terms of trying to just look at it in terms of delivery, how it's possible. Because the way it has gone today, we've just got, and the reason why it's happened is because this was seen as free money. Anganwadi Center initially came from central government, so you are on a CSS scheme, you access it, it's a demand-driven scheme, you pay 10%, 90% comes from central government, you're not worried about it. But the day this has stopped, the entire budget of a state government will go for a toss. And eventually this has to stop somewhere, because now the government itself is kind of reoriented its entire spending. So we are doing about, you know, 300 odd crores on schemes which are unique to J&K, Himayat and Umeed, to kind of make them some kind of self-employment schemes for youth, midday meal schemes. Then we have our own PDS subsidy of 450 crores. Add to it, if you were till last year, the kerosene subsidy of 350 crores from Government of India, 800 crores subsidy from rice, 400 crores in subsidy on wheat. We are really, as I said, not just talking about 5,000 crores, we're talking about 7,500 crores of current spend when you refine the model. So you're not really constrained by resources. And then associated with this, the entire administrative structure of a social welfare officer and the plethora of 3,500 people who monitor these schemes and who deliver these schemes, that if you keep adding to that, then... So along with this, you know, then if you were to see it in a much larger context, in, not just in terms of converting the current spending into cash, but associated administrative changes that you will see. And the savings on that, savings which have long-term implications on the salary budget, the pension budget of the government, I think it's a no-brainer to move away from what we are doing currently to what... But if you were to move away from the specifics of J&K, I think this move that towards direct transfer and universal basic income fits in with the larger changes that have happened in the fiscal system of India. A, over time, from 50s, 70s and today, you have distinctly moved away from a public investment driven thing to a public expenditure policy driven thing, where the current spendings are much higher. So you look at those six flagship schemes, whether it's Manrega or others, you decisively moved away from an investment oriented thing to an expenditure oriented model. And now you find that, barring the couple of years now, in terms of how the private investment has grown to replace public investment in key areas. So from the government's perspective, investment is not the one that is the key today in your public expenditure policy, but current expenditures are. And this will fit in with that kind of a change. Number two is Post-GST, as I see it, the budget goes in for a complete change. I mean, you virtually are going to have, the budget is a public expenditure document now. There's nothing else really that, so the structure of public expenditure and its levy mechanisms now need to be reoriented. Because you no longer have the big bank budgets over where you would have a whole thing of revenues and so on and so forth, all that somewhere past now. We focus really on the public expenditure. Within that, what has happened is also this whole trend towards reduction of CSS schemes and all will have a major change on how the subnational federalism will work. Today, now post-GST, a state finance minister is like a 12th man in the cricket team. He has no role to play in any of this thing that's happening on the Hindu side. Now, as far as expenditure is concerned, out of a plan size of 15,000 crores that I have, the free flexible plan I have is 2,000 crores. 13,000 crores is predetermined by central government through CSSs. So all I am doing is I am an expenditure agency who actually comes in, you know, kind of spends the money that they want me to spend in a particular thing. A CSS scheme comes, I can access that and be done with it. So I have no flexibility in revenues, no flexibility in capital expenditures. But I have some, and if you look at this scheme, the way it is today, we are running social welfare spendings, it's all driven by whether it's MNREGA, whether it's ICDS, whether whichever scheme it is. It is very, very rigid and I don't have flexibilities. So one way to help the overall system is to allow the states to adapt their own situations and give them some flexibility in the current expenditure spending. So if I get today through CSS from the central government 8,000 crores and I'm saying on the current side, not the the capex side, and 2,000 are national objectives of whatever literacy and nutrition, all that, the 6,000 crores if I pool and I'm able to do that in line with my social structures, in line with my own spending priorities, and given the kind of population I have, like for instance in JNK, we don't have an issue of extreme poverty, of the kind of deprivation that exists elsewhere. So can I reorient my spending in a certain manner? And then also utilize all the other things. I mean, some degree of market-driven thing like insurance, like the Construction Workers Board. So if I'm able to create a social security plan, pulling in all these things together, then the advantages of aggregation are much, much larger. And you may actually be able to continue with social intervention spending, which is where I think a lot of debate happens, is what happens with mid-meal schemes and all that. You could still continue with that and yet finance it from a budgetary perspective. But as I said, the only note of caution is that eventually one has to kind of factor in that the fiscal costs of UBI will be much larger than the DBT that you book on the budget side and on that head. That much I think we need to factor in. But there may also be choices that one must make very decisively. As I said, that I don't see UBI as a policy change, a regime change which can happen overnight. It certainly has to be phased, gradual, non-disruptive, because you will see a lot of clamor on this the moment you start moving towards it for a variety of political reasons. Now, I'm not going to get into the politics of it at this point of time, because I think there are huge advantages to this from a political perspective. But I think also where I'm not clear, and I think some amount of debate is required on the whole ethical part of it, that, you know, is it fair, the whole dilemma that Arvind was pointing out in terms of the Gandhian dilemma, that, you know, you are allowed to have an income without work. But that, I think, is more a philosophical debate. We need to look at it also in terms of the ethical theories of justice and see how the current, how the UBI will be taken. But having said all that, The point that I'm making, which I try to do in the budget, is that with the same amount of budget you spend, you can do a much better delivery through a very simple mind system. And in the course of perhaps 1 year, you could declare JNK as a poverty-free state or whatever, because the levels of poverty, again, are by one estimate 4% and by planning commission estimate 24%. You could conceivably think. And my argument for JNK largely for two very specific reasons. One is that the numbers are very small, as I said. I mean, 1.25 crore population, 15 lakh people below poverty line, 3 lakh families, you give 1 lakh per family, 3,000 crores. I'm already spending 7,000 crores. So how does it matter? And I can raise it to even the level of a per capita income of an average person in JNK is 58,000. So even if I was raised to 2 lakhs per annum per household, I'm still doing 6,000 crores and I'm raising to the per capita level. That just makes us, you know, at least statistically a very egalitarian society. So in some ways, it's a very simple arithmetic for JNK. But once we see how it works there, then perhaps even within JNK, one can splice it into various groups. You can do it either gender-wise or region-wise and see how it is. Pilots, I don't see the, you know, think of it in terms of a village, but if I would see it in terms of a state which has a certain federal flow system, it will restructure the entire federal fiscal system of India as far as public expenditure policy goes. Thank you very much.
Several brilliant minds that are at work on this concept, and Drabuji is one of them who has actually started applying and number crunching and getting into the actual operational part of UBI and related concepts.